And so, in the 30 years that I've been working in the arts, there has been, as well as this growing importance of art, a transformation in terms of who has been able to take part in the cultural life of most Western democracies. So, for example, integrated dance companies like this one, Dugout Dance from Oxford, or more famous Kanduko Dance from London, are now non part of the programme. And being able to represent disability culture, or the culture of different social or ethnic or racial groups, is an essential part of our social life. Being able to take part communally, together, in the life of your society is part of your democratic right. And I want to say one last point on this. This is a quote from the Argentinian writer Alberto Manuel. He says, "It is the reader who reads the sense. It is the reader who grants or recognizes in an object, place, or event a certain possible readability. It is the reader who must attribute meaning to a system of signs and then decipher it." I think this is a profoundly important idea, because when I'm talking about culture and art as the parliament of dreams, I don't only talk about the producers of culture, the artists, the creators. I don't only talk about whether you are able to perform as a disabled person on stage alongside non-disabled people. What I'm also talking about is your right to define, to find readability in something, to attribute meaning, to decipher. So in other words, I want to argue for art and culture as being as much in the mind of the person who is reading, who is watching, who is listening, who is viewing, as it is in the mind of the creator. And actually, it's in the dialogue between those two minds that meaning is made, that art exists, and nowhere else. It is not in the work of art, it is not in the book, it's not in the play text, unless the work of art is being looked at, unless the play text is being performed, unless the book is being read. And that's quite a difficult idea to get across to a Western European culture which for 200 years has sacralized cultural objects. We have turned them into sacred things. And I don't believe that's what matters about them. I believe what matters about them is the interactions that they enable to happen between people. The engagement of people with objects and the meanings that people find in that dialogue between the object and the mind of the person that made it and themselves. The object is simply a carrier, an enabler of meanings. Now I want to move on from that rather philosophical position to what that might mean in practical terms in a city like Lublin, where you want to have a strong, dynamic cultural life that contributes to a good quality of life and a prosperous and generous and happy city that people want to live in. The first thing to say, and the reason I've used this image here, this is an artwork by a British conceptual artist called Jeremy Deller. And it's called Acid Brass, and it came out of a complicated project that he did with a brass band playing acid house music. And I like it because it symbolizes the connections between everything. That there is not fine art over here, there is not classical music over here, and a rap over here, that the two shouldn't be. And that if you want to think about the cultural life of a city, you have to think about it as an ecology, where every part is influenced by and influences every other part. This is the classic characteristics of an ecology. That ecology is interactive, and I've already used the word interactive about the relationship between creator and recipient in terms of the artistic relationship. Ecology is complex. Complex things are different to complicated things. A computer is complicated. I don't understand a computer, but if I put in the effort, I could, if somebody taught me how it worked. Complex things largely defy understanding. They can't be understood because they keep moving, because there is no fixed point to them. Ecologies are evolving and adaptive. Today's ecology of Poland is not the ecology of Poland of 20 years ago, still less of 100 years ago. And today's ecology is not the ecology that you will have in 10 years' time. All of the parts are connected. Nobody is separate. As John Donne said, no man is an island. And that means that any part of the ecology can affect any other part of the ecology. So, for example, the music that is being created in some places may affect the music that is being created in other places by changing how people are listening to music.